Church say amen.
Amen.
We are eternally thankful to the God who sits high and looks low. We are thankful to him for the greatest twins spoken of in all the Bible. When you think of the twins in the Bible, it might be easy to allow your minds to become fixed on Esau and Jacob. But Esau and Jacob are not the greatest twins in the Bible. The greatest twins in all of the Bible are grace and mercy.
Amen.
You never see one without the other. And we have the grace of God because he is a God of mercy. We have the mercy of God because he's a God of grace. And no matter how good looking you are this morning, no matter how expensive your cologne or perfume, you're not here because you have figured it out or because you got it right. You don't smell that good. But it's because grace and mercy intervene. In the wee hours of the night when justice saw fit to take us, mercy stayed justice. God allows our golden moments to roll on just a little longer. And it is for that reason that we come to render praise to his name. And God is worthy to be praised. If you don't believe me, just miss a blessing. You will see that God is good. God is good all the time.
Amen.
Certainly we are appreciative to all of you for extending us this opportunity to be in the metropolis of St. Louis. You come from, originally from Chicago, but I preach in a small town, Saginaw, Michigan. Now in St. Louis, I feel like I'm in a big city. Happy to have my lovely wife with me. I'm asking her to raise her hand in case y'all don't know. I don't want any single brothers to have any mistresses. You might see a different side of me. But certainly we are just thankful to God for being here. We hope that something might be said to bless you as we preach the Word of God. I want to invite you to Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13. We hope you brought your Bibles. Romans chapter 13. When you get there, I want you to smile and say amen. Don't just say amen, smile and say amen. Romans chapter 13. Now, I wasn't going to preach long, but Brother Anderson said, speaker of the hour, so to keep him an honest man. Romans 13, if you'll meet me at verse number 11. From the pages of inspiration, we find these words. And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Is that in your Bibles? Let us, therefore, cast off the works of darkness. Let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envy. Put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. Beloved, if I might use a question to frame our conversation for this morning. The message is entitled, What Time Is It? What time is it? When we examine this particular text, one would have to wonder what was the motivation that the Apostle Paul, that great tent maker from Tarsus, why did the Holy Spirit inspire him to pen these words in this section of God's Holy Writ, to remind people of the time, to give consideration to the fact that it is high time to awake out of sleep. When you examine the text and study some of the background of the Church of Rome, you come to the stark realization that there were some realities in Rome that can easily parallel modern Christianity. In that it is easy for us as citizens of the kingdom of God to find ourselves in a state of relaxation. It is easy for the church to come to a point of comfort, whereas our personal growth, our development, and our progress in the kingdom become stifled. And every now and then, God has to do something. He has to say something that is designed to alert the senses of his children. Every now and then, God has to say something, do something, or represent himself in a way that is designed to stir the gift, to arouse the consciousness of his people, to tell us that we cannot be satisfied sitting on the pew of do nothing and standing in the aisle of do less. Every now and then, we must come to the understanding that it is high time that we awake out of our sleep. And so Paul pens these words, not only to the Christians of the first century, but he's telling us in the 21st century, yes, you might be comfortable. Yes, you might be in a state of relaxation, but now is not the time for comfort and relaxation. There is a need for the church to be invigorated with a greater vitality, a greater urgency, a greater need to be about the business of God. And this is the plea, this is the case that Paul lays out, not only for Rome, but for us, that now we have to move from comfort to understand there is a crisis.
Yes.
What is the crisis sin is about? What is the crisis sin has taken over, and it's not always because bad people do something wrong. Sometimes the problem is that good people do nothing. Good people need to wake up. For too long, the emphasis in the church has been for individuals to have a relationship with the church. And if not enough is said about having a relationship with the Savior of the church, we need to have a close and intimate fellowship with Jesus the Christ and understand that beyond these four walls, beyond the ceremony, beyond our coming together on a Sunday or Wednesday, there is work to be done in the kingdom of God. He's not looking just at those who sit by and those who come, those who assemble. He's looking at those who have awakened to the fact that we've got work to do. See, many want the church without Jesus. They want the singing on Sunday without the duty on Monday. They want strong preaching and worship, but they do not want to commit to a life of service. They want to go to the mountaintop on the first day of the week, but they want to live in the valley with their friends all week long. They want the privileges and benefits of Christianity without the sacrifice necessary to be a hard-fighting soldier. As we said this morning, we are not on a cruise ship, we are on a battleship. There is a war between good and evil. We have to consider what side of the fence we are on. We have to become awakened to that reality. If you will, bear with me as we study this particular text. Because when Paul says to awake, to understand that we need to awake out of our sleep, it's high time. There are some appeals that he gives to us. The first thing that I want us to know is that he's appealing to us to know the times. Now, if you will look carefully at verse number 11, again he says, and that knowing the time. Is that in your Bible? Yeah. Now, when Paul says knowing the time, he's not talking about whether or not it's 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock. He's not giving any consideration to a.m. or p.m. He's not talking about the four seasons that come in their rotation and go. He is telling us that if you understand the time, you have to recognize the power of God in your life to be aroused to what's going on around you. You see, when we contrast night and day, work is done in the day. Sleep is done in the night. And Paul suggests to us that some folk are sleeping because they think it's nighttime, when in reality it's daytime. That there are too many comfortable Christians, too many saints sitting. Look around you, there's work to be done. Evil is abounding. There's time for us to get busy about God's business. If you will, in John chapter 9, verse number 4, Jesus told us a long time ago that work is done during the day. You remember his conversation there in John chapter 9. And if you will, meet me at verse number 4. Jesus makes the point. He says, I must work the works of him that sent me. While it is day, the night comes when no man can work. There are, in our lives, the reality is that all of us aren't going to live forever. And there are some opportunities that God puts before you right now, that if you don't seize and take advantage of that opportunity right now, that you will never get the chance to do tomorrow what God may have given you to do today. Don't you know that God puts people in your path? He puts opportunities in your path. He allows you the opportunity to do some stuff. And all of us will be held accountable for what it is God has called us to do. Right. Ephesians chapter 5, as was read in our hearing this morning. The Bible talks about the word foolish. Now, I believe in higher education. But you can have education and still be a fool. Amen. I'm not trying to discourage anybody that's got an education. Amen. But wisdom, godly wisdom. Y'all know there's a difference between worldly wisdom and godly wisdom. The wisdom of God does not rest in the letters behind your name. It is irrelevant to God what school you went to and how many academic accolades you have achieved. One of the determining factors in wisdom, godly wisdom, is understanding what time is all about and understanding that time represents opportunity and that God gives you an opportunity. And if you use the opportunity right, you're wise. If you use the opportunity wrong, according to the Bible, don't say Brother Gibbs said it. If you don't use your opportunity right, it's foolishness. In Ephesians chapter 5, notice that the verse says in verse number 16, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Wherefore, be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Now, what you have to understand is that God's got a will for your life. Now, God's will is both general and specific. Now, we talk a lot about what God wants for us generally, and not recognizing that there are some things that God wants for you specifically. Now, generally, God wants all of us to be saved. Generally, God wants all of us to grow in grace and knowledge of truth. Generally, God wants us to be strengthened. Generally, God wants us to be admonished. Generally, God wants us to be encouraged and edified. That's some general stuff. You have to understand specifically, there's a call on your life. And one of the problems is that we have too many folk in the church that don't understand that they're called. Yeah, I got quiet on. Every now and then, as a preacher, someone asks me the question, preacher, have you been called to the ministry? Now I answer yes, but I recognize the answer I've given does not correspond to the question they've asked. You see, God has called me by the gospel to work in his kingdom. Now my job in the kingdom just happens to be preaching. Now some folk, when they talk about being called, they say, I laid my hand on the television. I felt something. I was talking to a Baptist preacher once, and he was sharing with me he was moving from Illinois to Florida. He had just retired from his job, and he said, I was in the shower one day, and God called me from in the shower to preach, and that's why I'm staying in Illinois to preach. And I said, well, maybe you just had some squeaky pipes. I can't see God calling you in the shower. But when we talk about a calling, understand that there is a calling on your life.
Yeah.
Y'all don't believe me. Turn back to Ephesians chapter 4. I want us to understand that we talk about being wise and using the opportunities that God has for us. In Ephesians chapter 4, in verse number 1, the Bible says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you. We talked about that word beseech this morning. It means to urge, to plead, to warn, to admonish. He says, I beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein you are called. Now, the word there, to look at it, in the word called, is the word vocation. And vocation simply means job. In other words, what he is saying to the church in Ephesus is that you've got a job that you've been called to do.
Yeah.
Now, what makes the church great is not powerful preaching. What makes the church great is not good singing.
Right, right, right.
But what makes the church great is when everybody in the church understands they've been called to a job.
Jesus
and project Jesus.
Why?
here than losses of life in Afghanistan. Something is dark, something is evil, something is wrong with mankind. But the real blessing in all of this is that the darker things are, the more valuable light becomes. You see, if you got a flashlight right now, and you turn on the flashlight, there's not a tremendous benefit to the flashlight. But if it were dark in this room, the power was not on, the sun was not beaming through the curtains, and you could not see your Bible, we could not see each other, the darker it is in the room, the more valuable the flashlight becomes. And so if evil is abounding, if the days are evil, remember the Bible says redeeming the time because the days are evil. If evil is represented by darkness, and it's darkness all around us, and we are supposed to be a reflection of light, projecting light, that means your value has just increased. Every time you see crime, you ought to say, my value as light has just increased. Every time you see danger, every time you see destruction, every time you see sin, every time you watch the news, every time you pick up the newspaper and you see that something's wrong in the world, when you see that evil is in the world, when you see there's violence, there is crime, there is wrongdoing, there's sin, there's iniquity, there's transgression, your value has just increased. Because that means there's light. You got a job to do. It's light. You've got something powerful that can make a difference. But not only does this text in Romans teach us to appeal to know the times, there's an appeal to Christian living. Now you can't just talk about being right. Amen. You've got to be right. But look at the text. Can we study the text in Romans 13? Notice verse number 12. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness. Can we stop right there? I don't know about St. Louis, but I can drive through Saginaw 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I can see some young folk wearing what looks like bed clothing. And you go into the Walmart grocery store, and you see pajama pants in the middle of the day. What that represents. Because at 12 or 1 o'clock in the day, if you wear pajama pants, a scarf around your head, that lets me know you ain't got no job to go to. Because folk that got somewhere to go, I'm talking about a job, folk that have something important in their agenda are not walking around the middle of the day with pajamas on. Now, why is that important? If you look at this word cast in the text, this word cast has reference to wearing pajamas. What Paul is doing is he's making an analogy to sleepwear. You don't wear in the day what you wear at night. When you go home, y'all look good this morning. Y'all got on suits and y'all got on dresses and you have on accessories. And as good as you look, when you get home, and I ain't never been to your house, the first thing you do is kick off some stuff. Take off some stuff. And some of y'all can't breathe right now because you're you get home and you let some stuff hang. a certain way that you dress when you're trying to relax and be comfortable. But when you are on the job, you don't go to your job with, you know, SpongeBob pajamas on. You don't go to the job with a nightcap. You don't go to the job with rollers in your head, scarves tied around. It's a certain thing when you're going to work. And that's why you better call some folks. You just don't show up to folks' houses. The folks don't want you to see how they really are. But this word cast here, when he says in verse number 12, cast off the works of darkness, he's making an analogy to nighttime clothes. And he's saying here, you got to get ready for business in the kingdom of God. But you can't be ready for service in the military of God, for business in the kingdom of God. You can't be ready for the work of God, and you're sitting up wearing clothing that says it's nighttime, when really it's daytime. So he says, cast off the works of darkness. Now don't look like you at home relaxed somewhere. This is about service in the kingdom of God. Now, what are the works of darkness? Well, he mentioned some things in the text. Now, let me help you with something, because every now and then, whenever you read in the Bible some sins, a listing of sins, I need to explain something. People will look at those sins and say, well, I'm not guilty of those five things or six things or seven things. And they will automatically tune out the message of the text. Because they'll say, well, he's talking about rioting and drunkenness, and that doesn't apply to me. Whenever you look at a text and there are a list of sins, that list of sins is not designed to be exclusive. That list of sins is simply designed to be random. In other words, it's just designed to be a sampling of sins, not a complete list of sins. In other words, even though it's a random list, your particular sin might not be on the list, but you get the idea. That's what it's saying. So don't look at these sins and say, well, Brother Gibbs, you wasn't talking to me this morning because I don't see my sin listed. Well, don't think that your sin is not listed. That's just a random sampling to put us on the path to understanding what sin is. Sin is sin. Yes. So whether yours is listed specifically, or you're looking at a general category, sin is sin. Right. Now he lists some sins there. He talks about rioting. When you study these sins and you get into their etymology or a word study on these sins, rioting has reference to wild parties and sexual orgies and brawling. That ruled out a whole lot of folk right there. Maybe you are talking to me. Drunkenness. Whenever you see the word drunkenness in the Bible, it is usually connected with rioting. Good time to look at Galatians 5, verse number 21. Let me just show you an idea of what it means here. If y'all don't mind, I'm going to let the Bible speak. In Galatians chapter 5, look at verse number 21 and 20. Give you an idea here. Here's another listing of sins. Back if you started verse number 20, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresy. Look at verse 21, Galatians 5. Envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Turn over to 1 Peter chapter 4. Let's look at verse number 3. I just want to show you. Just as in Galatians 5, you saw drunkenness with revelings. Just as in Romans 12, you saw drunkenness with rioting. If you look at 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter 4. For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles when we walk in lasciviousness, lust, excess of wine. What's the next word? Revelings. There always seems to be a connection in the Bible with drunkenness in people fighting, people participating in brawling and wild behavior, orgies, these things like that. In other words, you have to be careful about the things that intoxicate you. Now, can we talk about intoxication? Because intoxication doesn't have to be alcohol. And it doesn't have to be drugs. Intoxication is anything that changes your thinking, your speech, and your behavior. Now, for some people, a drink will change their thinking, their speech, or their behavior. But you can have some things about you. You can have an ego that will change the way you think. You can be intoxicated with your ego to the point you don't know how to talk to folks. You can be so self-absorbed in your own ego that it will lead you to fight somebody simply to protect your ego. You can be intoxicated with recognition. You can be intoxicated with power. You can be intoxicated with jealousy and envy. You can be intoxicated with some things that will mess up you spiritually. Your whole disposition will change. So when the Bible talks about drunkenness or intoxication, you have to be very careful and say, well, I don't drink, that doesn't apply to me. You can still become intoxicated with something that will mess up the way you approach life. Not only does he talk about rioting and drunkenness, he talks about chambering, that means fornication and adultery. He talks about wantonness. And wantonness is unnatural lust and a casual attitude towards sex. You know, there's a whole lot of casual attitudes about sex going on. Let me move on. Strife means contention. Hey, I've just been around folks that just like arguing. Folks that just like to fight. Folks that just like to be adversarial. Folks that like to take a contrary position. As children of God, we all have to be contentious people. Then he mentions in this list of sins here, he talks about envy. What you have to understand about being a community of believers, our job is to think more of others than we think of ourselves. But when I envy you, I automatically devalue myself because I devalue your person. The Bible says in the book of Philippians chapter 2, Paul talks about esteeming other better than self. I might not be jealous of you. See, what envy means is that I'm looking at something you got wishing I had. And what I have to recognize is that Democrats and Republicans might be fighting about balancing the budget, but God is not bankrupt. There are many blessed. If God could bless you, he can bless me too. And I need to stop looking at how good God has been to you and recognize that if I can look at him and not look at you, I might get my blessing. Cast off these works of darkness. Look at yourself and figure out what it is that you need to change about yourself. Now let's go back to Romans chapter 12. Y'all doing all right? In Romans chapter 12. Or chapter 13 that is. And he tells us to cast off the works of darkness in verse number 12. Then he says, let us put on the armor of light. Just as cast off means to take off nighttime clothing, put on the armor of light. It means to put on clothes that are appropriate and decent for daytime living. Now, we are not talking about actual articles of clothing, as we are talking about our character, our personality. You see, when you look at clothing, you can mask physical imperfections if you know how to dress. Big people like me ought not wear stripes. Because amen. There's some things you ought not wear. But if you have an imperfection, you can dress in a way that will hide the imperfection. And folk come up, girl, you sure know you look good today. Man, you sure look sharp today. And they don't know what you really have. That's why we wear some of the stuff we wear when we wear what we wear. But you can never mask a personality. Your character can't be hid. You can put a scarf around. You can put a hat on. You cannot mask your character. And what Paul is trying to get the church in Rome to understand is that if you want to be effective at using time wisely, your personality has to be right, because you are a representative of the kingdom. And everywhere you go, you don't just represent the Ferguson Heights Church of Christ. You represent the God of the Ferguson Heights Church of Christ. And so every person is either a Bible or a liar. Either you are a walking Bible or you are a walking liability to the cause of Christ. Let the man shall pray. Have you ever been to a store, had bad service? You go to Walmart somewhere and the cashier got an attitude, had bad service, and what do you say? I ain't never going there again. Walmart has more employees than some countries have citizens. And you allow one person to shape your opinion on a company that is bigger than one person. And you choose never to go back again because of one person. Y'all got that?
Yeah.
What happens when one representative of Ferguson Heights misrepresents the God of Ferguson Heights? And people say, well, I don't want to go to your church because there's hypocrites in the church. Well, you ain't met everybody in the church. You met one person in the church. And now your opinion about the whole church is negatively impacted because of one person. You see why it's important for us to put on the voice of Christ? Because all of us are representation. Finally, not only does he appeal to us to know the time, he appeals to us to live as Christians. He appeals to us to understand what unity in the body of Christ is all about. If there's one place you ought not experience hell, it ought to be the church. If there's one place where you know you love, it ought to be the church. I often say that when you come to church, your little light might be on red, but you ought to leave on green. You know, you go charge yourself in red because it ain't charged. It's green, let you know it's done. I might come to church, you don't know what I've been through this week. You don't know what dilemmas, what trials, what tribulations, what things have affected. And when I come to church, I don't come for nonsense. And excuse me if I get, as we say, a little happy in church. You just don't know how the Spirit is working on me. If you don't know what the Lord is doing, you don't know what I've been through in the last week. You don't know how many relatives I may have seen at the hospital, how many times I may have dealt with temptation, how many struggles I've had, how the devil has been messing with me. I move, I don't leave a foreign address, and he finds me every time. But when I come to the body of Christ, I ought to get something from my brothers and my sisters that will help me to make it just a little bit longer. Now, I want you to notice some, look at the text. I want you to notice some words here. Some simple words. In verse number 11, notice the word our and we. In verse number 12, notice the phrase, let us. In verse number 13, notice the phrase, let us. Now what does this mean? We got our, we, let us. We are not in this by ourselves. And if we're going to make proper use of our time, we have to see, this ain't about you and it ain't about me. This is about us. This is about we. This is about our. This is about us working together as a people of God to advance the very cause of God.
If I help you and you help me, we helping each other. If we are in this together, if we are encouraging one another, exhorting one another, strengthening one another, praying for one another, loving one another, esteeming one another, preferring one another, honoring one another, if we look out for each other, then this is what's going to happen. People will be encouraged. People will be strengthened. And you will draw people. When you become a better people, you will attract people who want to become better people because they will see what wonderful blessings are happening in your life. Understand that God works through people. And sometimes your blessing might come through somebody. I tell folks all the time, as hard as I try to work on preaching and being a good preacher, I can't always bless folk from the pulpit. Sometimes your blessing comes from a pew sitter. I want you to turn, as we prepare to close, I want you to turn to the scripture. I want you to turn to the book of Hebrews. And I want you to look at Hebrews chapter 13. I just want us to see something, the book of Hebrews chapter 13. As you're turning there, you can't have unity without folk loving each other. I said you can't have unity without folk loving each other. A part of loving each other is understanding that we don't necessarily have to like each other, but we do have to love each other. We might not like some external things about each other, but we have to love each other. And if it's hard to understand what it means to love somebody who's not always lovable, recognize that God has loved us. And if you think it's so hard to love the person sitting next to you, realize that it's hard for them to love the person sitting next to you. Amen. You ain't always so lovable, right? But here's something in Hebrews 13, verse number 2. The Bible says something here, and I want us to really look at this. And we've read this before. We are no doubt familiar with it. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Now many people have debated, I mean, Bible scholars, theologians have debated that word angels. Because the word angels there comes from a word that means a special messenger. Now, in the Bible, there are two types of angels. There are celestial beings, those angels, you know, the archangel. There are angels that are celestial beings. And so it could be that the Hebrew writer was saying that you never know when God has put a celestial being in your path. Now, remember that a celestial being in the Bible does not look like what Hollywood tells us an angel looks like. Because a celestial being in the Bible always looked like a human being. They didn't have wings and all that stuff we see on television. So it could be that the Hebrew writer is talking about a celestial being. But the word angel, which also means special messenger, doesn't have to be a celestial being. It can also reference a person who God uses for a special purpose. Now, why is that important? You never know where your blessings are coming from. You never know who God puts in your life to be the blessing. And that's why I say the blessing doesn't always come from the pulpit. There are some angels among us today that God will use them. And sometimes when God is using an angel don't know why he's being used. Sometimes somebody can say something or do something that blesses you. God told them to do it. He told them to say it. They don't know why they're doing it or why they're saying it. That's just how God operated. So when we understand the concept of unity and the concept of love, the concept of knowing how to treat folk, you better treat folk right. Because you never know where your blessings coming from.
and you never know who you mistreat, God is put there to bring you a treat. Amen. What time is it? It's time to know the times. It's time to think about it. The darker it is, the more valuable light becomes. If anybody here is struggling with self-esteem, evaluating yourself, feeling good about yourself, as I said, every time you look at something wrong in the world, your self-esteem ought to go up because your value is gone. Because you're the light. You're reflecting the light of God. You're projecting the light of God. You ought to see that you have value to do the work of God. He appeals to us to use our time wisely. Everybody has something to do. Everybody ought to be committed to the cause of Christ. I can tell you this, and I can say this without worrying about anybody getting upset. I'm never looking for a church where it's my job to be righteous for everybody else. I'm always looking for people who want to be encouraged, exhorted, admonished to work together to do the work of God. Everybody has been called to use the light that God has given us. And the more we work together, I'm praying for you, you praying for me, I got your back, you got my back, we can do some marvelous things. I'll say this, and we'll prepare to offer the closing. The idea in Acts chapter 17, the church went into Thessalonica, and they said, these are they who turned the world upside down. Right. I often maintain they should have turned the world upside down because Adam and Eve turned it upside down. So if Christians in Acts 17 turned it upside down, they turned it right side down. St. Louis is turned upside down. Ferguson Heights, we can turn it right side down. But we got to use our time right. We got to be unified. We got to work together. We got to take all nighttime clothes. We have to do that which is right, that which is pleasing to God. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all look so serious. Smile. It's all right. As we prepare the closing message, we give God thanks for this day. Hope something is said to stir your minds, to arouse your conscience. We pray that you've been blessed. If you're a member of the body of Christ, you need prayer. Don't worry about what folk will say. Come and ask for prayer. Really, I don't want folks talking about, honey, they're talking about you anyway. Just ask the church for prayer, and we'll pray for you. The Bible says, effectual fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. And if you're not a member of the body of Christ, something beautiful about being in the church of Christ is it's simple. You got three votes to get in the church, all wrapped up in one. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit. We don't have no deacon board that has to vote you in the church. You don't have to fill out no application. You don't have to have no tax returns attached. I see some stuff these churches do to get folk in. Lord, have mercy. All that to get in the church. All you have to do is just hear the word of God. You believe the word. Confess Jesus Christ, repent of your sins, and be baptized. The beautiful thing about being baptized is you become a new creature in Christ.
Yeah.
All your old stuff is passed away.
Yeah.
The Bible says 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you become a new creature in Christ. Your slate can be wiped clean. When your slate gets wiped clean, it doesn't matter who remembers what God has.
Yeah.
So if you desire to be baptized and desire to have prayer, come down to the standing.